Hebrews chapter 1, if you have your copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up there. I couldn't help but think, as that low end kind of reverberated, I would love to have had that in my car when I was about 17, you know? But I got it in my church when I'm 43. All right. So we're starting our study of Hebrews this morning. The preeminent Bible teacher, R.C. Sproul, said that if he were thrown into prison and could have only one book of the Bible with him, it would be the book of Hebrews. Why? Because it's so rich in both New Testament revelation and Old Testament revelation. It takes the full scope of redemptive history, and it points to the culmination of the gospel in Jesus Christ more than any other book of the Bible. When we approach a new study, typically what we like to talk about is the who, what, where, when, and why of the book. So who wrote it? Who were they writing to? Why were they writing it? That sort of thing. When it comes to Hebrews, a lot of that is unknown or it's uncertain. So for example, when it comes to Hebrews, we have no earthly idea who wrote it. We can make some educated guesses, but we cannot say for certainty who the human writer of the book of Hebrews was. I'll pull for a guy named Apollos. Apollos was the great orator that was mentioned in 1 Corinthians as being even more powerful in his communication than Paul. Paul was good, but Apollos was greater, was their struggle there in 1 Corinthians. But nevertheless, when it comes to the book, we know that it was either someone who was an apostle or they were operating under the authority of an apostle. That was the standard, that was the criteria for it to be included in the New Testament canon. Now, let me warn you up front before we get into this study. If you're new to Christianity, if you're new to First Baptist, we're going to be plowing pretty deep through this study. It wouldn't hurt to have an extra cup of coffee before you get here, okay? There's going to be some deep stuff. But when it comes to the New Testament, when we talk about the New Testament, this is called by theologians the New Testament canon. Now, not like a cannon you shoot a cannonball from, but a canon meaning a measurement. This is the standard that gets into what we consider the New Testament from Matthew to Revelation. Now, they didn't just pick books to put in it. They didn't just vote on it. There was a criteria. One of the criteria was that it either had to be by an apostle, someone who had saw Jesus face to face and had been personally called by Jesus to be an apostle. They either had to be an apostle or they had to be the surrogate of an apostle. For example, Luke was not an apostle. Luke was not one of the 12, but Luke operated under the auspices and the authority of the apostle Paul. So Hebrews was either by one of the 12 or it was by someone who was their surrogate. It was someone who they were instructing what to write. But unlike the other books of the New Testament, the author never identifies himself. We can't be certain who wrote it. We can't be certain to whom it was written. You say, well, Pastor, it says Hebrews. But here's the thing. The title of the books of the Bible are not inspired. An editor added the title later. We can assume it was written to the Hebrews because of the content of the book, but it was a particular group of Hebrews, and I want to make an argument for that in just a moment. Things like if I tell you to turn to John 3:16, you know, if you're familiar to Christianity, familiar with the Bible, you know that means John chapter 3, and then the third verse down has a 3 beside it, the chapter and the 16, the 16th verse down from chapter 3. But those chapter headings and those verse numbers are all added by editors. When John was writing it, he didn't write chapter 3, verse 1, 2. You know, he didn't write that way. We included, the editors included that so that we're all on the same page. So when it comes to Hebrews, we can't be certain who wrote it. We can't be certain to whom it was written. But here's one thing that we can be pretty sure of. It was probably written to people who were under the influence of the Essene community. Now, you may have never heard of that group. It was the unspoken, unnamed group in the New Testament. There were three groups when Jesus was traveling and teaching that were mentioned in the Gospels. The first group was the Pharisees. The Pharisees were your ultra-conservative, ultra-fundamental, right-wing extremists of the New Testament. They were the people who were the guardians of the law. So if there was a rule in Scripture, they not only proclaimed the rule, they wrapped three or four other rules around it and proclaimed those as being on equal authority. So when Jesus came on, they said, "You're a lawbreaker." Jesus said, "No, I'm not breaking God's law at all. I'm breaking your law, and that's different." Those were the Pharisees. We're familiar with them. On the other hand, on the other extreme of the spectrum, was the Sadducees. The Sadducees were the liberal thinkers of the day. Every religion has its ultra-conservatives and the ultra-liberals. The ultra-liberals in Jesus' day were the Sadducees. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in resurrection. They didn't believe in a lot of supernatural stuff. They wanted to reduce Christianity to some good ideas, or Judaism to some good ideas, to some thou shalt's and thou shalt not's, some principles about marriage and money and all that kind of stuff. They wanted it all practical. They didn't believe in the supernatural. Those were the Sadducees. As someone once said, that's why they were sad, you see. It's an old joke, but it always gets a laugh, all right? So Pharisees on one hand, Sadducees on the other hand. There was another group that was never mentioned in the gospel. They were the Essenes. The Essenes. E-S-S-E-N-E-S-S. I don't even know, but it's Essene. The Essene community. It was E-S-S-E-N-E-S. That's how you spell Essenes. I looked it up. The Essene community lived in the wilderness. They were the Amish of Judaism. They pulled out away from everybody else, not wanting any influence by culture because they didn't trust culture. They pulled away from everybody. They lived in caves. They lived in wilderness communities. They copied the Scripture. As a matter of fact, if you've ever heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls, how many of you have heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls? Right there. All right, the Dead Sea Scrolls were copied by the Essene community. And they were found in a cave where they had been hidden to preserve the copies of Scripture. So the Essene community believed that God was going to send a Messiah, but not just one Messiah. God was going to send two Messiahs. They believed in a political Messiah and a religious Messiah. When Jesus comes on the scene, many of the Essenes looked at him and said, perhaps this is the religious Messiah. And we still await a political or general type, well, military Messiah. But they believed both of those Messiahs were inferior to Michael the Archangel. And at the end of days, that both the political and the religious Messiah would bow down to Michael the Archangel. So, what many believe is going on in Hebrews is as the Christian community began to multiply and grow, a certain number of these Jews who had been raised on Old Testament Judaism, they were now coming into contact with the Essene community, and they were being influenced by their way of seeing the world. Now, one particular, many people believe that John the Baptist came out of the Essene community, that he was attracted to the way they lived and attracted to what they taught, but it did have a cult-like feel to it, and so he separated himself, started his own ministry. When Jesus came onto the scene, remember what John the Baptist said? Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So he's saying this is the, capital T-H-E, the Messiah, not a little a Messiah. This is the once and for all Lamb of God. This is the one to whom the Old Testament was pointing. Now, as the Essenes are beginning to influence these new converts or soon to be converts, see, some of these people were coming right up to the line. And then they were being distracted by this Essene community and they were wandering off course. Hebrews is written to arrest their attention, turn it back to center, and get them back to Jesus. Okay? So, with that in mind, let's jump into Hebrews chapter 1, look at verse 1. Long ago and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. Okay, now that begins what is called in classic argument, classic logic, and a fortiori argument. Now, I know you were getting up coming to church this morning and saying, I just hope Pastor tells us something about an a fortiori argument, didn't you? And a fortiori argument is a style of logic that great communicators would use that argued from lesser to greater. So if there was a large concept that we didn't perhaps agree upon, someone who was schooled in literature and logic may choose to employ a fortiori argument. That is, let's take something small that we do agree upon, and then from that prove the larger argument. Jesus was a master at the fortiori argument. You know, if you've read the Sermon on the Mount, you're familiar with this. Jesus would say, don't worry about what you're going to wear. Don't worry about your clothing, if you're going to have warm clothes in the winter and cool clothes in the summer. But don't worry about all that. Look at the lilies of the field. Consider the lilies. The lilies neither sow nor weave, but Solomon in all of his glory was not clothed like one of those flowers of the field. Then he would say, how much more? That's the fortiori argument. How much more does God love you than he loves a flower? He would make an argument when he would talk about, or consider the birds of the air. They don't sow and they don't reap, but God provides for them their food in season. They never starve to death. How much more does God care about the people that he's created in his own image? If he'll take care of the bird, how much more will he take care of you? So you see the way the argument works. That's called an fortiori argument. Now, the writer to the Hebrews opens up. He comes out of the gate by saying, God has spoke by the prophets in years gone by, but now by his Son. Now, he's laying the groundwork of his argument. Biblically speaking, you can divide time to about four major categories: creation, fall, Christ, new creation. It begins and ends in paradise. It begins in paradise, the Garden of Eden. God creates this beautiful planet. He creates this beautiful garden. He makes man and woman in his own image, and he says, fill the earth and subdue it. Be fruitful and multiply. But the enemy comes in and tempts man, and he falls. Then all that are born after him are sinners. That's the fall. So you have creation, paradise, fall. Then Christ comes. The whole Old Testament is dealing with the consequences of the fall and God laying the groundwork for a new Redeemer to come in. Then with Christ, he redeems humanity. From Christ to the very end, till new heaven and new earth, God is making all things new. He's changing the world by changing one heart at a time. Okay? That's the short story of Scripture. Now, from Christ to new heaven and new earth, that's considered the last days. So when you read in the Scriptures, in John would often say in his epistles, beloved, we are in the last days. And if you think, wow, that was 2,000 years ago, John said we were in the last days. How much more today are we in the last day, right? So this is the last days, and the writer to the Hebrews says, in these last days, God has spoken through his Son. So in the old days, from creation to Christ, God spoke through the prophets, Ezekiel, Isaiah, Daniel, Jeremiah. And the Hebrews believed God brought those messages by angels. So angels would come down and give the message to Jeremiah or Ezekiel or Daniel, and Daniel would in turn prophesy to the people. So the writer to the Hebrews is saying, days gone by, That's how he spoke. But in these last days, from Christ's arrival to new heaven and new earth, his major communication has been through his Son. Now, why is that important? Well, it's important if you have a Mormon friend or a Muslim friend who's trying to tell you, no, God is still giving authoritative revelation about salvation. You can always point to them and say, no, God spoke in former times by prophets, but today he's speaking by his Son. His Son is the once and for all culmination of the divine message of God to humanity. Make no mistake about that. You say, well, what about the apostles? Those who wrote and lived and taught after Jesus. The apostles are called witnesses. They're not prophets. That's why, to be an apostle, you had to meet Jesus face to face. So the apostles were witnessing to, clarifying, unpacking who Jesus was and what his mind was. But they were not prophets telling us something is yet to come or things would be changed. So here in the scripture, we have the truth, the faith, has been once and for all delivered to the saints. Well, what do the Mormons, what do the Muslims teach? They teach that God used other prophets and told things that at times are very contradictory to what had already been revealed. And that's problematic. So here, Hebrews begins by saying, God has spoken in latter times by the prophets, but today he's spoken in these last days through his Son, through whom he created the earth. Verse 3, he, that is Jesus, is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. Do you remember when one of the disciples asked Jesus, Jesus, show us the Father, and that'll be enough. And Jesus said, you see me, you've seen the Father. You don't get any more closer, better to the Father than seeing me. And here, the writer to the Hebrews says, Jesus is the exact radiance of the glory of the Father. What does that mean? Well, it's the early church compared it to the sun and the light of the sun. You can't think of the sun, the actual explosion, this atomic reaction that's happening in space, this star that's one of billions and trillions of stars, this atomic reaction that's hanging there in space. You can't think of the sun apart from the light of the sun. The two are coexisting. When I say sun, you think light. How many of you saw the sun this morning, the sunrise or the sun at any point this morning? Raise your hand. No, you didn't. You saw an 8-minute-old photographic image of the light of the sun. Nobody sees the sun. If you go out right now and you look up in the sky and say, there it is, preacher, you're wrong. What you are seeing is 8 minutes old. It takes that long for the light to travel from the sun to earth. It may have blown up, but we won't know about it for another 8 minutes. It may have went dark, and you won't know about it for another 8 minutes. You see how it works? Okay, why? Because the radiance of the sun, the glory of the sun, is inseparable from its essence as the sun. S-U-N, okay? Now, again, I told you an extra cup of coffee wouldn't hurt. When we're talking about the Father's relationship to Jesus, it is impossible for the Father to exist without his radiance, which is Jesus. So if we say things like, he's the only begotten of the Father, don't hear that and think, oh, wow, well, the Father existed and then sometime in eternity he created Jesus. No. There was never a time that the Father did not exist, and there was never a time that Jesus did not exist. You see Jesus, that's why Jesus could say, you see me, you've seen the Father. Because you see the light of the Son, you've seen the Son. Do you see how it works? Does it make sense? No. It will. Stay with us, okay? Drink more coffee and stay with us in Hebrews. That's why it's called Hebrews. You need coffee to understand it. Verse 3, the B part. He, that is Jesus, upholds the universe by his power. Now think of that. Not only did he create the universe by his power, he upholds it. It's not falling apart right now. I'm telling you, a really good scientist who gets really honest says we have no earthly idea why things even hold together. It makes no sense that it could even stick together and life could exist the way that it does. It makes no sense. It's because of the word of Jesus. He's perpetually holding it together. When you sing, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so," you need to know what comes to your mind when you think of Jesus is the most important thing about you. Did you know that? When you think of Jesus, you think of one who can, with words, hurl universe into existence. And when you think of Jesus, with his word, he keeps it together. Verse 3, the C part. After making purifications for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. That speaks of his finish once and for all. He concluded it. He wrapped it up. There was nothing else to add to it. He's finished, so he has a seat. He's not got to do any more work in purification, in redemption, in saving you, making it possible for you to be saved, making it possible for me to be saved. Everything it took for you to be saved, Jesus did on the cross. Now please receive that. When Jesus stretched out his arms on that cross, they were nailed to a cross of wood. The Bible says he bore our sins in his flesh. Whatever sin you're thinking of, he had it in his body. The wrath of God was emptied on the cross on Jesus. He absorbed the wrath of God on the cross. The last thing he said was what? "It is finished." You can't add to it. You can't take away from it. So it's not Jesus did 70% and you got to do your 30. Jesus did 99, but you got to do your 1. As a matter of fact, he did it all. You say, "Well, what do I do?" You accept it. You receive it. You believe it. That's all you can do. "Oh, no, Pastor, I can add to it. I can stop drinking, stop cussing, stop smoking, stop dipping tobacco. I can start getting baptized, going to church, reading my Bible, going to Sunday school, and doing all that stuff that Christians do. I can do all that. Then I'll be okay." Listen, friend, if you could get saved with Nassau County tap water, why did he send the Son of God to die? "Well, Pastor, what if I go on pilgrimage or what if I become a missionary?" He would have let you do that instead of Jesus dying. Instead of Jesus suffering the wrath of God, if there were any other way for you to atone for your sin, if you could do enough pilgrimage and do enough giving, if you gave everything you had, got baptized every day of your life, and did everything you could think of doing, if that would wash your sin away, God would have said, "Just do it that way. Rather than my beloved, precious Son that I've loved from eternity past, having to become human and suffer and bleed and die and absorb the wrath of God, let's do it that way. Let's do it through your way." Your way doesn't work. Jesus finished the work and had a seat. It was done once and for all. Now, here's his argument. Verse 4, having become as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. So he's saying, why would you worship an angel when there's this other guy who is so far superior? He's the eternal power, the almighty God, the Ancient of Days, who with a word created that angel. Why would you worship an angel? That's the argument that he's making. He's going to make a bigger argument, but that's what he's making now. Now he's going to give 7 references to the Old Testament to prove his point. He says in verse 5, "To which of the angels did God ever say, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you'?" None of the angels. He said that to Messiah. He said that to Jesus. That's the only one that he said it to. In Psalm 2, verse 7, this Messiah is declared to be not a son of God, but the Son of God. See, there's a sense in which the angels were called little s, plural, sons of God. There's a sense in which you are the adoptive children of God. But no one in all creation in Scripture is called the capital S, the Son of God, that's begotten of the Father. Not begotten the way I was begotten, but inseparable in essence, the way that the Son and the light are together. Or again, he says, I will be a father to him, and to me he shall be a son. This is 2 Samuel 7, verse 14. Speaking of the descendant of David who will once and for all accept the throne and rule and reign. Verse 6. And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says, let all of God's angels worship him. Psalm 97, 7. For a Jewish thinker, it was the ultimate blasphemy to call anything God that wasn't God. That's why idolatry was such a big deal in the Old Testament. That's blasphemy. And so when you, if you saw a real life angel, like angels, you know, rarely but occasionally would show up. And when people saw angels, they were terrifying in their power. And people would often fall down to worship them. You know what the angel always said? Get up. Don't worship me. I'm like you. I'm a created being. We both worship Jesus. Okay? That's what the angel always did. So it says here, he commands the angels to worship Jesus. Now, what he doesn't command the angels to worship each other or Michael or Gabriel. They're all giving their worship, their adoration, their appraisal. They're giving it all to Jesus as being of highest worth. It goes on in verse 7 to say, of the angels, he says, he makes his angels winds and his ministers a flame of fire. So that is, in Psalm 104:4, he is referring to the Messiah, the one who's coming, that is Jesus. He empowers the angel. So why would Jesus, the Messiah, bow down to the angel if he's the one who gave power to the angel? Verse 8. But of the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever. Of the Son, he says, your throne, O God. A Jehovah's Witness comes to you and says, where does the Bible ever call Jesus God? You say, right there. Right there. And it's over and over. Thomas doubted. He said, I'm not going to believe it until I put my hand into his side. Jesus shows up and he says, there's my hole in my side. Put your hand in it. And he falls down and worships him and says, my Lord and my God. And Jesus did not correct him. So here is one of the examples. Your throne, O God, Jesus, the Son, is forever and ever. The scepter of your uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, now listen to this, both the subject and the object are identified as God. Therefore, God, your God, so Son is God, Father is God. People say, well, where did you Christians get the concept of Trinity? Somebody must have came up with that thousands of years, you know, hundreds of years after the church was established. No, it's all over Scripture. Therefore, God, your God, he goes on to say, is forever and forever, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. Verse 10. You, Lord, laid the foundation of the earth from the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. They will all wear out like a garment. Like a robe, you will roll them up. Like a garment, they will be changed. But you are the same, and your years have no end. And to which of the angels, has he ever said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to serve for the sake of those who are going to inherit salvation? So here's what he's saying. He's saying, we love angels. Angels are great. They help us out tremendously. They've probably helped you out in ways you don't know they helped you out. But they're not Jesus. And Jesus is the one we worship. He's the one we focus on. Now, y'all follow me up to now. Now, he's going to make his a fortiori argument. You ready? Say yes if you're ready. All right, look at your neighbor and say, this is deep. I just thought I'd try. He says, therefore, based upon this idea that angels are awesome, but they're not Jesus, based upon the idea that the angels are the ones who brought Old Testament prophecy, and that was a big deal. Therefore, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by angels proved reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? Here's what he's saying. You ever heard somebody say, boy, I'm glad we live in the New Testament. I'm just glad we're not Old Testament saints, because I'm telling you, they had it rough. You messed up in the Old Testament, the earth would swallow you whole. Fire would rain down from the sky. Boy, I'm glad we're under grace and we're not under the law. That Old Testament stuff was rough. I feel sorry for the Old Testament folks. We're New Testament people. Have you ever heard anybody make that argument? The writer to the Hebrews is saying, you've got it all wrong. Here's what the writer to the Hebrews is saying. He's saying, the word that came through angels, through those prophets in the Old Testament, proved reliable, and every sin had its just retribution. That's the ground swallowing up, the fire from the sky. If God took that so seriously, how much more will we never escape if we neglect the great salvation that is offered through the exact radiance of His glory, Jesus Christ? So it's not like, boy, he was mad in the Old Testament, he's happy in the New. No, no, no. He was dead serious in the Old Testament, and he takes it to a whole new level in the New. You following? This is what he's arguing. Why? Because it's not the crime that determines the penalty. It's the one to whom the crime was committed. Okay, now this is deep, but it's a big deal. We went to the zoo yesterday. My family, we went there and we saw all these little kids, and I'm just sat there thinking, I'm just so glad I don't have little bitty kids anymore. These people have to go home with these little jokers, and they worry me to death. I'm telling you, they just get on my last nerve, you know. But I thought, one day I'm going to have grandkids and they're going to be perfect, you know. They're not going to have a sin nature. I just have that feeling. But I'm watching those little critters, and they're just peculiar. They do the weirdest stuff. Imagine a little 3-year-old boy, I've seen it happen, takes an earthworm and he just pulls him apart. Now he has 2 earthworms. Then he pulls this one apart. Now, if you were that child's father, if you're a good father, you would go to that child and you'd say, now, son, that's just cruel. Let's not do that to the earthworm, okay? But you wouldn't immediately place him into therapy, would you? Kids do stupid stuff. But suppose it was a kitten. Suppose he took the front right paw of the kitten and pulled it off the cat. That's not even funny. I shouldn't have done that. But suppose it happened. Okay. You start to worry about the child, don't you? These kids that take a magnifying glass and burn little insects, you kind of get worried about it. Those kids grow up and be axe murderers. You know, you just worry about those kids. So if he's pulling the arms off the cat, something's wrong. He needs to see somebody, right? I hope y'all agree with that. What if it was his sibling? Little sister. Now, why did that change from the earthworm? Well, Pastor, the nobility of a cat is different from that of an earthworm. And the nobility of a child is different from that of a cat. And the higher the nobility of the creature, the more severe. He's doing the same thing. It's the same crime. He beheaded the earthworm. He beheaded the cat. What's the difference? Same crime, it's beheading. No. No, you get locked up forever for doing this other stuff. You understand? It's the same crime, you say. Friend, it's not about the crime you committed, it's to whom the crime was committed. We have a lab in our backyard. We have a dog that we like to play fetch with, and he loves to play fetch. But sometimes I'm mean, and sometimes I will lie to my dog. The way I'll lie to my dog is I'll take the little green ball that he likes to chase, and I'll pretend to throw it, but I don't throw it. And he will run across the yard looking for that ball, smelling for that ball, and it's like it's never happened before. And he comes back, and he looks at me like, "You lied. You just lied." Okay? Suppose I take the ball, I give it to the dog, I go in, and I lie to my wife. Lie is a lie. Sin's a sin. Yeah, but I may be sleeping with a dog if I lie to my wife, you see. Well, suppose from there, I get in the car, and I'm driving through Yulee, and I'm just tired of the traffic. So I speed, and when the officer pulls me over, I lied, and I said, "That wasn't me driving. I just have sat down while you turned your head. I sat down in this car." And then suppose we go through a series of court cases that ultimately land me in the Supreme Court of the United States, and I, under oath, lie to those justices on the Supreme Court. Is the penalty any different between lying to my dog Levi and a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court? That's a much bigger deal to lie to the Supreme Justice, wouldn't you agree? Multiply that times infinity, and you have some sense of the wrath and the penalty for lying to God. You understand it's not what you've done? Because we can always sit down and say, "Pastor, you tell me I'm a sinner, and I'm not going to argue with you I'm a sinner, but I'll tell you what, you ain't met my boss. You think I'm bad, you ought to meet him. You think I'm bad, you ought to see that my neighbor, she's awful." And there's always somebody we can point to and say, "Oh, yeah, I've got my faults. But what about her? What about him?" There's always people worse. But here's what I'm telling you. It's not about which sin you committed. It's about who you sinned against. And we've all offended the same deity. Whether it's a big sin like Osama bin Laden or whether it's your little Baptist sin, it's the same deity that's offended. And because of that, we all need a Savior. And there's only one who qualifies. And here's what the writer to the Hebrews is saying up to this point. He's saying, if in the Old Testament it was bad and there was just retribution, how much more if you neglect so great a salvation? He says, how do you plan to escape? It is said that at the last days, that when Jesus returns and his eyes of fire are a light upon this universe, that heaven and earth will flee from his presence and no place will be found for them. Where are you going to hide? If the whole universe can't hide, where are you going to hide? What is your plan of escape? I suggest that you take the advice of the psalmist. David writes in Psalm 2, verse 12, "Pay homage to the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way, for his wrath is quickly kindled. Blessed are those who take refuge in him." Well, it's him we're afraid of. Have you ever considered the fact that Jesus Christ is your greatest threat? And he's your only hope. It is Jesus Christ. People say, "I'm afraid, I don't want to die and go to hell because then I'll have to stand before the devil and the devil will judge me forever." No. You ain't got to fear the devil. He's under the same wrath you are. The devil isn't hurting anybody in hell. He's getting hurt in hell. Jesus, hell is the wrath of God revealed against sinners forever and forever and forever and forever and forever and forever without end. That's what hell is. That's the biblical concept of hell. So in hell, the wrath of God revealed against Satan forever and forever. In hell, the wrath of God revealed against any sinner forever and forever who has not taken shelter in the Son. You say, no, Pastor, God judges sin in hell. No, he doesn't. He judges sinners. You don't see sin cast into hell. You see sinners cast into hell. It's a big deal. It's very important. That's why we've made it very clear in this sermon, and if you've been here any length of time, and if you've heard the Word of God, that's all there is sinners. That's all we have to work with. Well, what hope do we have? The only hope you have is taking shelter in Jesus Christ and saying what he accomplished on the cross on my behalf was enough, and I'm going to bow before him. I'm going to do homage to the Son. I'm going to bow a knee before him. I'm going to say, you are my Lord, my boss, my Savior. I give my life completely over to you. I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. Here I am. Receive me just as I am. Amen. And if that's not happened, amen, that's worth clapping over right there. If you've not gotten there, this is a setup. God's brought you to this point in time, at this place, with everything that's been going on in your life, is to get you to this point of decision. And the opportunity of a lifetime only exists in the lifetime of that opportunity. I can say with every cell in my body, whosoever will, let him come drink of the waters of life freely. I can say with every fiber of my being, behold, today is the day of salvation. But I can make no promise about tomorrow. Today you can be saved. What will you do with the opportunity of a lifetime? Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're here and you're not certain that if you died today that you know Jesus as your boss and your Savior, there's no reason in the world for you to walk through those doors uncertain, unsure. You can settle it once and for all. I'm going to ask even now, Josh, would you come and would you stand on my left side? Where is Pastor Shed? Pastor Shed, if you'd come stand on my right side. They're going to be here. If you need to talk with somebody, they're going to be here and be ready to speak with you. I'm going to come stand right here in the middle. And if you're here and you're not certain where you're going to spend eternity, let's settle it today. Come to one of these men or myself and just say, I need to be saved. We'll take care of it. We'll get you with somebody who can pray with you and settle it and show you what it means to be a Christian. If you're here today, maybe you've come and you've visited, and today you're sensing that I need to be under the preaching of the Word with people who, make no bones about it, we're all sinners in need of a Savior. And I need to be in this environment on a regular basis. I want to be a part of this family of faith. You know, attending a church and joining a church is the difference between dating and marriage. When you're dating somebody, you can kind of leave anytime you want to, but when you commit to them, you're marrying them. You're saying, I'm in this for the long haul. And some of you need to say, at this season in my life, I need to make a commitment to this church, and they need to be committed to me, and I want to be a part of this family of faith. Maybe as I pray, a husband would take a wife by the hand and say, honey, I'm ready if you are. A father take a child, whatever it may be. Come as a single adult, whatever it may be. A teenager, and say, I'm ready to be on the team. We would be thrilled to receive you this morning. Father, in Jesus' name, families are making decisions. Individuals are making decisions. God, people right now are deciding, is this going to be the day of their salvation? Maybe some are saying, I need to be baptized, like those that have followed through this morning. Today is going to be the day I let that be known. Others are saying, I want this to be my church home, and I'm ready to make it official. God, give them the courage to come.